We're going to pick up again in the book of Acts in chapter 13 this morning. In fact, there are several quotes there. We're dealing with them one at a time as we give attention to how apostolic preaching, our brothers, used the writings of Moses and the Psalms and the prophets, the writings of Brother David, Brother Asaph, and others, and expounded those writings, opened them up, and delivered the truth of the gospel to their hearers, Jew and Gentile alike, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And they used these writings, of course, because those writings had been granted to the people of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, down through the generations, down through the centuries, as a testimony of what God was doing. There in the garden with his arch enemy, so to speak, and the whole human race, God announced what he was going to do. Amen. And in those words, just those few words, which he didn't explain, and they're not expounded anywhere in Scripture. Those words are never cited again in Scripture directly. But there's a sense in which the whole of Scripture is an exposition of that statement that God made to Satan with the whole human race listening. And so the brothers, according to their commission, went out from Jerusalem into Judea and Samaria and even to the uttermost parts of the earth, delivering this testimony, this record of what God had done in the earth, right in the midst of them, especially there in Israel, primarily there in Israel, and that land was the focus of these events. This is the stage where it took place, you might say. And here in Acts chapter 13, Brother Paul and Brother Barnabas are in the city of Antioch of Pisidia. We have two Antiochs, Antioch of Syria, where all the brethren were gathered there for some time and ministering to the Lord. Certain prophets, teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, Niger, Lucius, Manian, and Saul, later known as Paul. And the Spirit directed them to send out Saul and Barnabas for the work to which he had called them. So they arrived there in Antioch. They'd been in Cyprus where they preached the word. And in fact, the Roman governor requested an audience. He'd heard about these things. He was interested in the things made known to Israel and requested this audience. And that was where the only time in the book of Acts where the apostles used their power, their God-given divine power, to injure someone. Where Bar-Jesus was stricken blind for a time. Man who tried to interfere with the preaching of the gospel. Don't try to do that. Then they went on to the mainland again. And here in Antioch, they went into the synagogue and were invited to preach. After the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them, saying, "Ye men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on." So Brother Paul stood and began to deliver this message. I want to focus on verses 26 through 33. Our primary text is in verse 33. That's where the quote is. But I wanted to pick up here in verse 26, where he says, begins in earnest now, looks him right in the eye, "Men and brethren." This is a synagogue audience. Men and brethren. Children of the stock of Abraham. Well, that would get the attention of everybody there. "And whosoever among you who feareth God." Well, that was the rest of the audience, the Gentiles. There were a few Gentiles gathered there that Sabbath. "To you is the word of this salvation sent." That was likely a word that they didn't hear very often. Maybe if the scripture that they were giving attention to that Sabbath was from Exodus, they might have heard the word salvation. Or maybe if it had to do with the words of Jeremiah or Ezekiel, where they would talk about salvation for Babylon. But this was a different kind, we know. For they that dwell at Jerusalem and their rulers, because they knew him not, he's already introduced Jesus, because they knew him not, nor yet the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath, those in Jerusalem did not know. Paul just declares it straightforward. They did not know. They knew him not, nor yet the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath. They have fulfilled them in condemning him. And though they found no cause of death in him, yet desired they Pilate that he should be slain. When they had fulfilled all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a sepulcher. But God raised him from the dead. Now this is the first of two times where Paul simply declares the resurrection. He gives no proof, physical proof. He doesn't mention you can go to Jerusalem and see the empty tomb. He doesn't say anything like that, like men, American writers do in so many places and so forth nowadays, and developing a what we might call a forensic, is that the word I want? Scientific, forensic, yes, forensic. I get my vowels turned around. Developing that scientific, supposed scientific view where we can go in there and handle the evidence and get the fingerprints and get footprints in the dust and so, things like that, you know. That's what they do, isn't it? Get blood samples and fragments of the bullets or a fragment of the knife or something like that, you know, so the weapon that was used and all those kinds of things, and they go into the lab and they test this and they examine this and they make drawings and so forth and so on. None of that. Simply a statement. But God raised him from the dead. And he was seen many days of them which came up from the Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses unto the people. And we, note that pronoun there, we declare unto you glad tidings. Brother Paul's including himself now in this company of witnesses. Who are his witnesses unto the people, and we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise was made unto the fathers, God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children. That's one statement there. Glad tidings, how that the promise was made unto the fathers, God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children. In that, here's the second time, he hath raised up Jesus again. That couldn't be any more direct statement. And again, with no appeal to physical evidence, simply a declaration, an announcement, a report of what happened. He hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second Psalm, and here's the quote for the day, "Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee." I appreciate Brother Al introducing my lesson for this morning earlier in the week. He cited this text a couple of times. I told him that. And he also cited a text that I had been speaking from last week at work. And so that was I appreciated that affirmation of the things that God has granted us. This quote is one of the premier texts of apostolic preaching and writing. It's quoted twice in the book of Hebrews. In 1:5 and 5:5, as we call them, those references. The content of it is a central aspect of God's revelation concerning Jesus of Nazareth. Now, in this sermon, in this delivering this message here in the Antioch synagogue, Brother Paul doesn't refer to the Master as Jesus of Nazareth. Brother Jonathan.
Yeah, seeing these things, it's really a matter of faith. You mentioned
yes.
These things, the physical proof approach, but it's kind of a lose-lose with that approach anyway, because if a person has faith, they don't need that. If a person is unbelieving, that won't matter. So,
that's,
I mean,
true.
Like, either way, you're not getting anything done with that kind of approach.
That's
so
true.
Yeah, faith is the focus, faith's mm-hmm. the issue.
Yeah, it is. you, in a courtroom where physical evidence is being presented, you got experts for and experts against the physical evidence,
that's
don't
right.
you?
That's right.
Depends on what you want to believe. Brother Ricky and then Brother Tony.
Brother Tony had before me and I was...
Oh, okay. Brother Tony, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I saw. I wanted to say this, that now, you notice what Paul and all the apostles and all those, they're forcing the listeners, actually, they're forcing them to receive a testimony. Now, if you go and you do like men try to do, you gather up evidence, physical evidence, then you're circumventing what God wants to take place. That it is required that we have faith. Mm-hmm. And this test, that's why it declares the testimony. We're going to have to receive a witness.
Yeah.
You see, so that puts man in this place where they can receive a faith. You see, and if we go around and we do like you said, then that's what men do. They take pictures of the shroud and they, all kinds of things.
Yes, oh yes.
You remember? And they try to present, you know, this evidence so that we can take. But see, God doesn't want that. He wants to give you. You got to have faith because it's more.
Yeah.
The road on the journey. The glory is going to require faith all along. So you, at some point, you're going to have to receive this faith for the testimony. I can see this clearly and, and how that the apostles, they declared these things on and over and over and over so our faith could take hold of it.
That's right. That's right. Brother Rick.
Yeah, just along the same lines, the things that are surely believed among us, the Bible says, are things that cannot be demonstrated tangibly.
That's right.
Yeah, amen.
How do you demonstrate that Jesus has been destroyed? How can you demonstrate that Jesus put away sin? Nobody standing there at the foot of that cross could see that happening.
Yeah, Satan has been
destroyed.
How
could you see that God was laying on him the iniquities of us all? And nobody saw him raised from the dead.
That's right.
That was purposefully done.
Yeah.
Amen.
See, this methodology is God ordained.
But that is an appeal to faith.
Yes.
That's the appeal to faith, because actually the report of the thing happening is actually stronger than if you just saw it with your eyes.
Amen.
And so that's what's so important to see here. When people want like a physical evidence, well, we already know what Jesus says about that. It's a faithless generation that is seeking for that kind of a sign. That's not how it's going to come.
Amen. Amen.
Actually, Jesus did give very many miracles. The same people who saw these miracles are the ones who crucified him.
Yeah,
so
that's right.
This doesn't work.
Yeah.
And as you said, in the court of law, they can twist evidence. They can do whatever they want to. They can have it right before them and still get the person free.
Yeah.
Even though they're guilty. So that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
But it's faith.
Mm-hmm.
Believing.
Yeah.
And when Paul speaks the truth, those who are called believe.
Amen.
But having said that, though, there is a confirmation that that has taken place.
Yes.
And that's where the believer's conversation comes in.
Yeah.
That's like it's a demonstration of Satan's destruction.
Yeah.
It's a demonstration of all that Jesus has done, because we are living epistles.
Right. Yeah.
But if you're looking for the reality of that taking place, you're going to have to believe it.
Yeah, that's right. Sooner or later, sooner or later, you come to this statement of the Lord himself. Blessed is he who is not seen and yet believed.
Amen.
Sooner or later, you have to deal with that.
Amen.
So.
There is evidence. That evidence is your faith itself.
Yes. It's the beginning point. It sure is. So, this revelation concerning Jesus of Nazareth, and I wanted to make some point of this phrase, this label, if you will, this identifier, designation in Scripture. Jesus of Nazareth. Even demons addressed him that way, didn't they? Mark 1:23, Luke 4:34, they addressed him that way. When Jesus was gathering the first of the 12 to himself, Philip said, findeth Nathanael, and said unto him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. That's how men were, this seems to be the, one of the first identifiers from a human perspective on a horizontal level. It was Jesus of Nazareth, again and again and again. The blind men on the Jericho road, they asked the crowd, who's passing by? What's happening? Well, some of the crowd said, Jesus of Nazareth passes by. Now, of course, that's toward the end. This is during the last couple of weeks, in just the last 8 or 10 days of his public ministry. just days later, the soldiers came to arrest him in the garden. Yeah. Jesus went out to meet them. Said, "Who are you seeking?"
Yeah.
Twice they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." The woman at the fire in the house of the high priest, who saw Peter warming himself and spoke to him, "Thou also was with Jesus of Nazareth." Pilate made the sign above the cross, nailed to the cross. The writing was, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The angel at the tomb, the morning, the women arrived there. The stone was rolled back. "Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen." Later that same evening, on the road to Emmaus, when the stranger asked the two, Cleopas and his friend, who were walking and talking, "What are you talking about? What's your discussion?" They told him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people." I wouldn't be surprised if that was the last time those brothers used that identifier for the master. They probably never called him that again after this experience. He was a lot more than Jesus of Nazareth to him from now on. On the day of Pentecost and at Cornelius' house, Peter identified him as Jesus of Nazareth for the sake of his hearers. He wasn't just Jesus of Nazareth to Peter anymore either. But for the sake of the hearers, hearing this for the first time, that was a convenient way to identify him. And the Lord himself, when he appeared to Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus, he said, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus of Nazareth." See, that was prominent in their culture and in all of their thinking about this man, this rabbi from Nazareth. That was how they identified him. And then finally, Paul used that in his defense before Herod Agrippa. "I verily thought with myself I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth." But this is not the way the Father identified him, is it? God never called him Jesus of Nazareth.
That's right.
Yeah, two times. God, by his own mouth, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. This is my beloved Son. Hear him," the voice said. So this is the high view. And we know it's the real view. It's the fuller view from our perspective. It's not the fullest view. There is a larger view than that even of his place before he became the Son, of which we don't know very much. So our quote comes from the pen of Brother David. Brother Paul's citing this ancient text to the audience in the synagogue here as he builds a case and presents the gospel. And he does so referring to God's promises, which springs from this revelation of God himself. This revelation of God, of the Father and the Son, of God speaking to the Word before he became the Son. That's what this language is about. Before he became the Son, before the foundation of the world and the world began. This revelation of this aspect of God's eternal purpose being revealed in the earth, inducting the Word of God to be the Son of God. As I said, we don't know very much about his, what we call his pre-existence. As Brother John said, "He existed before me." Even though John was of the earth 6 months older. So this Psalm of David is a significant revelation of God's redemptive work through the gospel, and it's cited by our brother Paul. I want to start here giving careful attention to Brother Paul's words in verse 32. "We declare unto you glad tidings," how that the promise was made unto the fathers, God hath fulfilled the same unto us their children, in that he hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second psalm. Someone mentioned this week that this is the only psalm that we know of its number. This is the second psalm. Even in their day it was. In the second psalm, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Wanted to turn back to that psalm here and give a little bit more attention to the context. Why do the heathen rage? The people imagine vain things. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, against his anointed. Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. That's what the kings are saying, see, the heathen and the people. That's what they're saying. Against the Lord and against his anointed. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Now our quote comes from these words of God addressing his enemies. That's something to think about, isn't it? And brother Paul's now citing it as to the resurrection, which all took place within a setting of opposition, didn't it? A setting of conflict, powers, warring, one with the other. Who's going to succeed? Who's going to come out on top? Who will be victorious? Who will dominate? See, that's the context of this whole thing. Now, Brother Paul has said these are glad tidings. That's what he's announced to his audience, hasn't he? I have good news for you. I've come to tell you good news. But the Jews sitting there listening, if they were familiar, depending on how familiar they were with this particular text, you know, they likely knew some texts better than they did others. We don't know for sure how familiar they were with this text. But if they were familiar with it, they knew the conflict inherent in it. This was a battlefield. This is talking about a battle. Mortal enemies, so to speak. One trying to dominate the other. One trying to control the other. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. This is the announcement. Shall speak to them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. Yet, here's his words, yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. God does battle with his words. All he has to do is speak. I will declare the decree. It's already been decided. Now he's going to reveal it. The Lord has said unto me, thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. Someone's going to be born. A son. A child. Well, those are the words of Brother Isaiah, aren't they? Some 200 years later. A son and a child born and given. Thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. Now, Brother Paul, he's declaring this. We declare unto you. We declare these things unto you. The witnesses began in Jerusalem doing this, announcing the record that God made in the earth among the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Let me remind you of these words of Brother John as he looks back over the decades, the latter part of his life. He's had decades to digest these things, so to speak. And they've actually gotten larger. There's more to his thinking now. This is what Sister Nikki was talking about in our opening this morning. There's more, see. So there's more in these words than when he witnessed them, when he actually witnessed them. He recognizes the height, depth, length, and breadth of them, so to speak. And we're familiar with these words. We cite them on a regular basis. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, our hands have handled, Now, Paul's here in Antioch declaring these things in a real compressed manner, whereas these words of John open this up. He opens this witness up. And it's more than just historical fact, isn't it? Which we have looked upon, our hands have handled, of the word of life, in parentheses now, for the life was manifested. And we have seen it and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life. He's not just talking about an earthly life, is he? He's not just talking about historical places and people and things and events. It's eternal life. See, it's gotten bigger. Eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. That's what this psalm talks about, isn't it? He was with the Father. He's declaring the decree. This is the decision that's been made in the courts of heaven. And God's going to insert someone then in the course of human events. He's going to insert someone as a son. That is, someone who comes from him. Many of us here have sons sitting here with us today. They came from us. We came from our fathers. I had, you know, my father was at the meeting for a little while this week, and people came up to me and said, "Is that your dad?" I thought it was. I thought that was your dad. See? And we know that when men saw and heard Jesus of Nazareth, well, what was their reaction? At first, some thought he was the son of Joseph. Nazareth, the son of the carpenter. But it wasn't very long before people were saying, "Whose son is he?" Yeah. They had heard he was the son of a carpenter in Nazareth, but this is not, these are not the words, and these are not the doings of the son of a carpenter from anywhere, amen, much less from Nazareth. Amen. You remember, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Not that it was a wicked, evil place, but something of this stature?
Yeah.
See? We talked about that this week. Several of the speakers noted this. The otherworldly nature of God's working. It's not like men do things.
That's right.
Who would think that such things would come from these places, from these people, and in this manner? Well, no one, would they?
Praise God, amen.
It has not entered into the heart or mind of man,
right,
has it?
Right.
Yeah, but God hath fulfilled what he said he would do. I like to expound it this way. Is that God says what he's going to do, and then during the time of what I called earlier this week gestation, you know, Sister Maddie's in a period of gestation right now. Rachel's in a period of gestation. They're carrying their little ones, and the time is approaching when they'll be delivered into their arms. So during this time of gestation, then, God drops hints here and there. He makes statements revealing aspects of what he's doing. Now, faith wants to hear these things. Brother David, he wanted to hear those things. And others down through the generations, they wanted to hear these things. The prophets, Peter mentions those prophets that searched intently the time, the place, and the person the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating. Oh, those are words, aren't they? Those are weighty words, words with real gravity to them. You see, God is working these out, so he says what he's going to do, then he lays down and reveals hints along the way as he fulfills these things, and then he says, he sends someone to say, "It's almost here, it's right at the door," and then, of course, it happens. But then, of course, we have to, because of our weaknesses, we have to have him tell us what happened.
Yeah.
And then we have to be informed about what it means. And then we have to be told what to do with what it means. All of those things we have to be told. So, Sister Melissa.
I was thinking about your statement that you made, that the Lord does battle with his word. So I've been thinking about this as you've been talking. We know the word became flesh, so that's pretty powerful right there. And the Lord is the only one that actually has power in his words, but he distributes this power to those who would preach the gospel.
Yeah.
So that's why it's important to declare the gospel, because the gospel actually has power to do a work.
Amen.
And it divides. It does a work. Whoever hears it, it does a work in them.
Yeah.
Those who hear it in unbelief and those who believe it. So that's why it's important when we preach and teach that we only use the words of God, because if you use something that another man's come up with, there's no power in that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There are some other examples. I've got one example here in my notes of how the word of God worked in somebody, and then they spoke words that expanded and affirmed those things. So, Brother Ricky.
Yeah, in Isaiah, I think it's 50:12. Actually, I'm not sure what chapter it is, but it says how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet.
Yeah.
And it gets to the end of that one section there. And the message of the glad tidings is this: the Lord reigneth.
Yeah.
See, the second psalm represents human resistance
mm-hmm.
to the will
yeah.
of God.
Yeah.
That's what it is. They gather together against the Lord and against his anointed. Jesus gave this challenge: destroy this temple, and in 3 days, it'll be raised up again.
Yeah.
And remember, when he died, they actually sent officers to guard the tomb.
Guard it, yeah.
Try and keep the body
a dead man
in the grave.
Yeah.
But the resurrection represents God's answer to human opposition.
Yeah.
God doesn't have any formidable opposition.
That's right.
To stop him from doing what he wants to do. I think of what Daniel said. Man, this was given Nebuchadnezzar. But he said that the Lord does what he wills in the armies of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth.
Yeah.
See, none can stay his hand.
Yeah.
We have in the gospel a wealth of confidence for the people of God.
Mm-hmm.
There are a great many things that you face every day over which you have no control.
That's right.
But Jesus faces no opposition.
Yeah.
And this is something that has to go out when the resurrection is preached.
Mm-hmm.
See, is that even when the opposition comes, he just raises Jesus from the dead. See, and I don't know of any greater foe for humanity than death itself.
Yes.
Look at how it's swallowed up humanity all these years.
Everyone.
Now Jesus, he just goes back from the grave.
Yeah.
He's ascended into heaven. So this is a source of great confidence for all of God's people. He's in absolute control, and whatever he is intended to do, he is going to do.
Amen. Yes. There will be no opposition.
Praise God.
So, Brother Paul is now speaking about these things. He's glad tidings, declaring them to this audience who've not heard. Brother John is writing to people, his words. I just read part of this, but we know that he's writing to people who have heard, and they've believed. They've joined the band, so to speak. They've gotten on board. They're believers. They're disciples of Jesus. But Paul's audience, they're not. They haven't heard about these things. They don't know. Jews, Gentiles, they're listening. And yet, he doesn't approach them, as we've said before, with suggestions and pleadings. Oh, I want you to believe. I want you to hear these things. Please listen to me. No, not at all. He commands them to believe. He just delivers the message, and they have to choose. There's no pleading going on here. There's no attempt to persuade resistant minds. It's simply a revelation, a declaration of what God has done. Heaven expects men to believe.
Amen.
Why would anybody, if you know anything about the Most High, be surprised at the ways that he works?
Amen.
That they're not like men would do. And yet, especially in our modern culture and society, our modern church culture and society, I've heard it for 40 years, arguments about how to present this message and shaping and training. I've been trained. Some of us here in this room have been trained to shape our message in a way so that it will make it more palatable, so that people will be able to more easily accept what's been said. Is this easy to accept, what Brother Paul says here? Maybe the people in our generation are more ignorant, than these people were. And so that's why the message needs to be made palatable. You think maybe that that's what some of the teachers have thought. Religious teachers we're talking about now. Yeah. We're not surprised that the world is that way or would think that way. The world does it. The entertainment industry, the retail industry, the people who want to sell you something, they constantly adjust to make it easier to lift your money. Yeah. Don't they? To get from you what you want. Make it easier for them to do so. God doesn't work that way. Brother Jonathan.
It's coming back to the matter of faith is the issue.
Yes.
God hasn't given you like a broken hand to reach out and take all of what he's given. Is faith not adequate? I mean, that's what you have to come down to.
Amen. Amen. Good thought.
I mean, when people are trying to make it easier to understand, what they really mean is we're trying to make it where flesh can comprehend it. That's really what it is, because faith already can. You don't have to modify it, because God's given you something to comprehend it as he's presented it.
Amen. It's contained in the message, isn't it? Faith comes. Yeah, the message delivers faith to you. So, brother, I think Brother Paul expected people to believe. We know he did. We know he expected people to believe. Now, he wasn't surprised either if someone rejected it. But he did expect it to be believed. Let us do the same, brethren. Let us do the same. These glad tidings. One more thing about this. You think again. Think again about some of the old prophets and the way they delivered their message. That day when Nathan went in to speak to David and he told that little parable about the shepherd and the rich man stealing his sheep and butchering it, did he accommodate the message so David would not be offended? And so David could more easily understand. Now, some would hear that and think, well, he told that way so David would be more easily offended. No, it would be more easy for David to understand. Well, there's a little bit of an element in that, but really the whole thing just exposed David's heart, didn't it? Yeah, it exposed his heart's what it did, because David understood. He understood with just a few words, he understood. Brother Dan. Yes.
Not knowing the word of the prophet.
Yeah.
It's not associated with what the miracles really, this is what he did, but it's associated with what he said.
Yeah.
And knowing God. Remember, he said, my sheep, hear my voice.
Yes.
This didn't trip up Jesus. He talked about, if you don't believe me, believe the miracles. But that was just like that was a partial believing.
Yeah.
That was like they that know God must know that he is.
Yes.
And then it was a reward. So little later than what you were reading, he quotes from another of the prophets in verse 41. He says, a word which you shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you.
There you go.
So
yeah.
Our responsibility when we declare the word of God in the gospel is to provide the setting that God has already spoken of,
mm-hmm.
of setting the word in a place where men have access to it.
Yeah.
The availability, if that's even the right word, is set before them. But the responsibility, God has actually taken upon himself to bring
yes.
it to the hearts of men.
Yeah.
A little bit later, just this word you used about persuading, in verse 43, the persuading is more associated with those that have already believed that they would continue in the grace of God.
Yeah, yes, yeah.
We don't persuade.
That's where the persuasion is applied.
When you persuade people that are coming to God and you try to persuade them by earthly means or devices of men, you're actually contending and God won't work there.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So get out of the way and don't muddy up the water. Let the Spirit do his work. In other words, to convict concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. So, glad tidings. God promised in the garden what he would do. He began to work it in Abraham and in David. He announced it in the prophets Isaiah and Micah and Malachi. These are just a few examples. Now these gathered in this synagogue would hear again of these things. Glad tidings, of course, are what the angel spoke of over the hills in Bethlehem to the shepherds. Glad tidings are what the angel spoke about at the tomb. Glad tidings. Now Simeon and Anna at the temple, all they had to do was see that 8-day-old babe in Mary's arms. And they believed. They were glad to believe. They were willing. They were aggressive to believe, weren't they? They didn't have to be persuaded.
Amen.
Their faith was strong and willing. And of course, we have more than the kings and the prophets had that the Master spoke about. They long to see and hear these things. Well, we have. Woe to those who are casual or flippant.
Amen.
About these things.
Amen.
Oh, we all know that, sure. But what's that mean to me? We've talked about that before, you know. Woe to people who have that view, that take them for granted. And they'll even take these things sometimes and turn them into a license for their personal benefit, maybe to build their career or to profit them in their possessions and finances and so forth.
Amen.
We know how the world uses the good things that God gives them, don't we? Use them for themselves, for their own name, for their own benefit. There are those in the religious world that do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. These tidings are from and of and to God first. Now, faith will benefit because we've already talked about faith is packaged in the message for the willing heart. There's a reward in it.
Amen.
For the believing heart and mind.
Amen.
And some things for the body as well contained in this message. So Paul talks about the promise. The promise. God is the one who initiated, executed, and defined the details of the promise. It's not for men to do. It's not a promise about our agenda and our human interests and human appetites. Now, that's how some turn it. But that's not the case at all. The genesis of it all was in the divine heart and mind. How could it be any other way? We talked about God leaking out this information during the time, the in-between time, so to speak, and gave it to those chosen by his wisdom. The prophecy, as Peter writes, the prophecy came not in old time by the will of men, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, and they became then trustees of this message, and they were faithful. That's why we have it. They were faithful in their handling of this message. In another way, Peter describes it in this manner. According to his divine power, he hath given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby, this glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. See how these things, the Lord works these things and reveals these things. He declares, Peter's declaring here the magnitude of these things, their implications and an application of the power that works in us. That by these, here's his words, that by these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So they announce God's promises and then they make an application of it. This is what it works in those who believe. This is its power active in us who have trusted it. This power, the power of these promises, well, it changed Abram into Abraham, didn't it?
Amen.
It brought forth Isaac from a dead womb, didn't it? It changed Jacob into Israel, didn't it? This same promise in some form, this same promise confronted the adopted prince of Egypt and drew him back to his natural heritage, so to speak, of the tribe of Levi in Israel. Remember, Moses was a Levite. And for this heritage, he forsook Egypt. He said, it's not worth it. I don't care. I want this other. I've got to have this other. It was the promise. It was the promise, see. These promises stirred the heart of a shepherd boy who, when he was thrust into a battlefield incident, took up a stone and put it in his sling and knocked down a giant and used the giant's own sword to behead him. Just as he said he would do, didn't he? See, the promise worked in David, so David made a promise. I'm going to cut your head off with your own sword. And he did it. A boy. An untrained shepherd boy, untrained in military tactics. But he didn't use military tactics, did he? He used the tactics of a shepherd boy. And that's how God works. See, never entered the heart or mind. There sat Saul at the back of the army trying to figure out what to do. And there was a shepherd boy out in the front killing a giant who was fully armed and fully trained and fully experienced. But he just lost his head, didn't he? Yeah. David knocked him down and cut off his head with his own sword because of the promise of God, see? This is what it works in us. That promise made to the fathers 33 times in Scripture, in the Old Covenant Scriptures. Well, no, this all through the Scriptures. Getting ahead of myself here. 37 times, Old Covenant, New Covenant Scriptures. We have a reference to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Four of those 37 times, it was Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. Made to the fathers. Seven of those 37 times was when Moses, in the record we call Deuteronomy, was retelling their history through the lens of these promises that God had fulfilled. Of course, the nation became known as Israel. And they had immense pride in that, but most of the time, their thinking about it was too small. It was too low. They simply thought about themselves, didn't they?
Yeah.
When they thought of their fathers. National or earthly pride. When God's intent by it was for them to think in otherworldly terms. Yeah. Supernatural, we would call it. Without the power of God's promise made to the fathers, Abram and Sarai were impotent and barren. Isaac and Rebekah were also for 20 years, weren't they? They were married for 20 years, no children. So God created this nation. He created this nation from these two couples through the second son of Rebekah, the one who should not have received the inheritance according to man, but he did. God's angel later renamed him Israel. And God called Moses with these words that we remember, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's what fully awakened Moses, brother.
Yes, you talked about it works in us. This is what you're talking about, how the promises of God work. And this is works in us. And this is what we really depend on.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you talked about earlier, with a lot of people will teach men who come to them how to convince men and persuade men. You know, using words and special techniques of speaking. But really, what we're supposed to do, actually, is preach the gospel.
Yes.
And then we desire the power of the Spirit to come mm-hmm. in and do a work.
Yes.
Actually, if we did believe that, we just as well just sit in the pew and do something else. But now we read in the Scripture, and you know, here we've got Paul is preaching in the synagogue to Jewish people who've come to the synagogue.
Yes.
Okay, so he's presented a message to them that would be different than the Paul in Athens, who speaks to a bunch of heathens, or even Philip, when he's speaking to the Ethiopian eunuch there, he starts the scriptures. What I'm saying is we see where the man is and we go from there, but we don't use anything else but the scriptures, particularly the gospel, to persuade and convince men.
Yeah.
And like I said again, so we depend on the Spirit to convict men or to train, teach men, whatever what it needs to be done.
Yeah, yeah. And we want to bring them into the school of grace for grace to teach, don't we? Yeah, do that teaching of the details, you might say. Now, if anyone would object to this, what we need to do is look at the fruit.
Yeah.
By their fruit you shall know them.
Right.
Brother Dan.
That's important. It's not that we preach and teach the gospel word in a cold manner, a detached manner.
No,
one is stiff-arming men. See, when you see them teach or speaking, it was in earnestness. Paul talked about it, how he had a desire for his country.
Yes,
you see a great, you see the mercy of God through the person, but ultimately they're not going to rely on the devices of men. They're going to leave it in the hands of God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, that reminded me of these words about Brother Paul in Rome, talking with the Jews about these things. It says that they appointed him a day. This is Acts 28:23. Appointed him a day. There came many to his lodge, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning till evening.
Yeah.
What is it, 12 or 14 hours? He was willing to extend and expend himself in this effort to persuade, to present this. Now these were men who knew the scriptures. These were the Jews in Rome. And so they expounded and testified, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets. So the Most High stirred up Moses and called him to himself using these words. Then later, now we're talking about the promises to the fathers. The promises to the fathers. Later, Moses saved the whole nation from God's wrath by mentioning Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember thy servants, he said. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, look not into the stubbornness of this people, nor to the wickedness, nor to their sin. This is when God said, stand back, I'm gonna wipe them all out, and I'll make a nation out of you. When God remembered the promises, his wrath was stayed for a time longer. So this phrase, Brother Paul using this phrase about the fathers there in the synagogue, well, that would stir up a lot of thinking in these minds, and even among some of the Gentiles who had become familiar with Scripture. It would stir them things up. You think of godly Cornelius, who had a genuine heart interest in the revelation of God. God hath fulfilled these things, he said. It's like I was reminded of the words here at the end of Joshua's record that says, the Lord God gave them rest round about according to all that he sware unto their fathers. They failed not aught of any good thing which the Lord had spoken to the house of Israel. All came to pass. That God had done this down through the generations again and again. Jesus' own public ministry was a fulfillment, wasn't it? Remember what he said to the elders there in Jerusalem? Search the scriptures. They are they which testify of me.
Yeah.
Of course, they didn't understand, but that was a fulfillment. In his childhood synagogue, he read that text from Isaiah and said, this day is the scripture fulfilled in your ears.
Amen.
Yeah. And to the two brothers on the road there to Emmaus that evening, he said, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. Fulfillment, see? Fulfillment. So Paul is declaring these things to this audience. He'd done it in other places. Of course, now we've received the writings of Brother Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, Peter, James, Jude. Those are our New Testament writers, if you will, New Testament scripture writers. We've received all of that. We've received all of that. We don't want to be among those who are unlearned and unstable, do we? Those are Peter's words. The unlearned and unstable rest the scriptures to their own destruction. Yeah. This audience, and they think about the fathers, this audience was a part of the fulfillment. We are their children, Paul says. You are their children. To us, their children. Of course, now, we need to understand the kind of children that we're talking about. Remember what Brother John said to the elders who came from Jerusalem to interrogate him? God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. Yeah. In fact, Abraham had many sons, didn't he? Many sons had Father Abraham. Some of you others sing that song when you were young. He had 7 sons beside Isaac. And then Ishmael had 12 sons, long before Jacob did. But God's promise and his choice in the promise was the point. See, God's choice was the point. Not even those who believed was not the point. God's choice was the point first. God's choice is what worked the rest of it together. Later, as an exclamation point, so to speak, of this thought, Brother Paul would write these words. We're familiar with these words. They are not all Israel which are of Israel. Neither because are they the seed of Abraham are they all children. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Well, in fact, because of another of Brother Paul's writings, several spoke about this, cited that this week. The seed, it's one. It's not many. It's one. Yeah.
Brother Gene, I thought what the Lord said to Abraham, he said, take now thy son, thine only son, whom thou
yes.
lovest. So there's a sense in which Abraham had one son.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Brother, yes.
It's important to note in this text that when God fulfilled all these things when Jesus was raised from the dead. And that's when the Apostle Paul makes this statement, this day have I begotten thee. It's not referring to his birth, but his resurrection from
yes.
the dead. That's
yes.
when God...
That's what he's nailing down.
God, Christ. And if you look back in all the other places of Scripture where this is mentioned, you can see that. That's always the context. In Psalm 2, it's the when all the kings and the rulers of the princes of this world gathered together against the Lord, that was at his crucifixion.
Mm-hmm.
Then it was after that, in the second psalm, he says, this day have I begotten thee.
Yeah.
And the same here. Paul associates this with the resurrection of Christ. That's when God
yes.
begot him from the dead. Hebrews 1 is similar to, the context is similar to the second psalm, where he's talking about the Christ's preeminence over angels and men, because by inheritance he's obtained better. Well, he didn't receive the inheritance when he was born. He received the inheritance after he rose from the dead and ascended to heaven. And
yes.
that's when, in Hebrews 1, he says, this day have I begotten thee.
Yeah.
In Hebrews chapter 5, the context is his priesthood. Well, Jesus wasn't born a priest.
That's right.
He didn't become the high priest until he ascended up into heaven.
Yes.
So in Hebrews 5, that's the context. And is his priesthood, he says, this day have I begotten thee.
Yeah.
So that, one more, in Revelation chapter 1, Jesus says that he's been the first begotten from the dead.
Yes.
So you can see in all these where... and what you're just talking about, the promise given to the fathers. Well,
mm-hmm.
the promise wasn't that they would have a little baby, but that they would have a king.
Yes.
And
a triumphant ruling king.
A prophet that the people would hear, a ruler.
Yes.
Well, that was after he was begotten
yeah.
from the dead.
Yeah. Now, he did have to be born. He did have to become a man. the Son of God on earth and the Son of Man. But it was in order that he might then be this acceptable sacrifice, this one who could lay down his life and take it up again to enter then into these the fullness of the things that God had prepared. In fact, after talking about these, the promise made to the fathers and to us, our children, he hath raised up Jesus again. See, that's the
Amen.
That's the declaration. That's the announcement. These other things are further exposition for those who already have faith. But for now, he's announcing these things. He's declaring these things, that God has raised up this Jesus. Peter had done the same thing on the day of Pentecost, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, he declares, after talking about they handed him over to godless men to be put to death. Wicked hands, crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up. Then later again, Peter in chapter 3, in his sermon there, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up, denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. Ye denied the Holy One and the just, desired a murder to be granted to you, killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And then he says essentially the same thing in Cornelius' household. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. We are witnesses of all things he did in the land of Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hung on a tree. Him God raised up the third day. He just announces it. He just declares it, brother.
If you think about it doctrinally, it's even becomes more wonderful, because it's kind of hard for us to consider someone being born and begotten from the dead. All that's exactly what happened. It was like the grave was the womb.
Yes.
Where Christ was begotten. But if you think about that doctrinally, that's exactly what happens to us when we're born again. You know, we're buried with Christ, we're made dead, and then that's when we're born again.
Yeah.
We're born again from the dead.
Yeah. This is how Brother Paul expounds it. For those who've already passed through this, it's like when we talk to our own children about things that happened before they comprehended, but they're still people. You know, little Nathan, he's a people, and the little ones back here, they're people. The Arnold's two little ones who they're not comprehending things now. They're not going to remember the renewal this week, but they're still people. We want them here. Matt and Nicole's little ones, little Render, we want him here. We're caring for him. We're going to talk to them. If the Lord tarries, we'll talk to them about these things in years to come. So, Brother Dan, you had your hand up.
Yeah, there are some places, there's a double beginning, really. There are some places, like in John 1, where it talks about the only begotten of the Father. It says, we saw him. The Word was made flesh, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He was unique in that way, in that the Holy Ghost overshadowed Mary. Joseph was not involved. Where in John 3:16, it talks about the only begotten again.
Yeah.
But the greater look and the greater work is unto salvation. See, the first beginning is his association with man, so that we could be associated with him in the resurrection from the dead.
Amen. Yeah. It's the phrase, he became the Son so that we could also become sons. He had to pass through this before the door was opened for us. He had to become the door, the way, truth, and life. Brother Larry.
There's a scripture in Zechariah 4, chapter 6, verse, which says, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. That's the way all these things are done. It's not by the intellectual powers of men.
That's right.
It's not by this years and years of study and then learning calculations. It's simply with a power of spirit, not simply purely by the spirit of God Almighty.
Amen.
God Almighty can rest upon us, and he used us, any one of us here.
Yeah.
As small as we are, or as large as we are, as immaculately dressed as we may be, or as poor shabbily dressed as we may be, whatever our situation may be, it makes no difference for the Lord. He can use us as we are.
Yes.
If we're available to him.
Yes.
And he will.
Yes.
We'll just be available to him.
Yeah, that's right. So that's the exhortation, that we yield ourselves in faith.
Amen.
Brother.
The sense in which the death of Christ represented humanity's rejection to Jesus as the Christ. It did. He came into his own. They received him not. The death was like where that was demonstrated that they had rejected. And
They thought he was smitten of God. They thought that God had reached.
Yes.
And God had, in fact.
Yes, he had.
For the sake of cursing him.
Yes.
And paying for sin, had.
For a time.
But the resurrection represents God's demonstration of his reception.
Yes.
Of his son.
Yeah.
And putting him in this high place.
Yeah.
That he had, in fact, received him.
Yes.
And that had to be declared in Jewry.
Yes.
That even though they had all rejected him, God had put his king on his holy hill. And
yes.
The resurrection was the demonstration
yeah.
of that.
Yeah. In some sense, this was Jesus' own renewal, wasn't it? In some sense, his recovery, his return. Of course, he himself had nothing to return from. This was for us. For the Father first, that God might be just and the justifier of those who have faith.
Amen.
So the Father and all of us who believe.
Amen.
These things were accomplished for them. So this resurrection of the Savior is his enthronement, as the psalm says there. I have set my king upon my holy hill
Amen.
Of Zion. They judged him worthy of death, but he was the Prince of Life, as Peter said. And so when the work was finished, this temporary work for a time, my God, why have you forsaken me just for a time in order to accomplish this? We don't know why it was 6 hours earth time, human time. It was 6 hours. The earth, for three of those 6 hours, the earth became dark. Not a word was spoken. Not a sound was made. And then he cried out, this cry of being forsaken. And then he declared he was thirsty. I thirst. They gave him something to help clear his voice, so to speak, clear his throat, so he'd hear those last two statements. It is finished. And Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.
Amen.
So the work was finished then. This great transaction that we call it. This purpose for God's glory, wisdom, and truth, unknown to men and angel until its fulfillment, but now revealed that the Godhead, a member of the Godhead, became flesh
Amen.
And dwelt among the lost sheep of the house of Israel, gathering his sheep to himself. They're lost, but when they heard his voice, they came, didn't they? They came. Now, Brother Paul is declaring this in this synagogue, and we know the reaction, don't we? Why, the next Sabbath, practically the whole city gathered. It stirred everyone so much that, you know, someone could have said they've turned the world upside down. They would later say that in another place. Well, that's what God has done. This confession about the Son, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Of course, God was the first one to make this statement, to grant us this revelation, that this Jesus of Nazareth was in fact the Son of God, his beloved Son, in whom he was well pleased. Brother Paul says that the Master himself made this good confession before many witnesses. Pilate, he confessed it before Pilate. He also confessed it before the council, didn't he? Are you the Son of the Blessed One? Said the high priest. Yeah. Now, of course, that confession is what we all make. As Brother Paul writes in his exposition, what saith it? That is the word. He refers to the word. He's got another quote here. What saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. Those are Moses' words, by the way. It's not far from you. That is the word of faith which we preach. Now, Moses wasn't referring directly to faith, but Paul could look back and say, this is what he's referring to, this word of faith about what God would work. This prophet that God would send, would raise up from among their own people. See? The word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, shalt believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. See, he's got a quote at the, like bookends at the beginning and end of this statement here. Scripture. And then he expounds it about how this truth, this reality works in the believing heart. It works in the believing heart. So this is some, brethren. We too have confessed this, haven't we? And God's power is working in us. Now this is what Brother Paul is delivering to this audience in the synagogue here in Antioch. He doesn't need to urge them to believe. The message itself is urgent. If they have a heart, it's like the audience on Pentecost. They interrupted the speaker. What shall we do? Because they believed. See, faith will act. Faith, there are some religious folk who don't see this, of course, that faith contains in itself an obedience. An obedience according to its nature. And it stirs up the heart. And a person who has this faith, they're not going to be stopped. They're going to interrupt everything. They're going to stop everything. Wait a minute. Tell me this. I've got to know. See, that's faith crying out. I want to know. Well, these people here in Antioch, this is how it worked, that over the next 6 days, the whole town was in an uproar. Of course, it was a good kind of uproar as far as God is concerned, as far as the gospel is concerned. Now, we never hear any more about this, these believers in Antioch. No letter was written to them. Paul and Barnabas had to leave the city under threat. They did return, I guess they did return. They appointed elders there. So there was a body, there were maybe several bodies of believers there. There was a church in Antioch. We never hear another word of them. Now we'll return to this again. There's two or three other quotes here. I'm just dealing with each one of them individually for us to get a hold of this working, how God worked in the scripture, how the apostles delivered this message contained in the scripture. So we're glad to do so. Brethren, you have any other comments? Brother Tony, in conclusion?
By faith, yes. Faith is self-contained.
Yeah.
And as the scriptures say, it comes to men.
Yeah.
And when it comes, it prompts men. It prompts men to do something.
It does, it does.
That's why these men cried out, men and brothers,
yeah.
What shall we do? Paul,
yeah.
Peter hadn't got to that yet.
Yeah.
You see, but
yeah,
he was ready.
He hadn't offered any invitation. Well, yes, he had. The whole message was an invitation. Well,
But anyway, my point is, faith requires obedience. It calls for it.
It does. It calls for repentance. It calls for confession, genuine faith,
Amen.
And it calls for this obedience of faith. Amen. Yeah, brother.
Keep thinking of kind of generally what's coming across and what he is declaring, not by coercion but by affirmation. That's how.
Yes.
That's how you persuade men, is by affirmation.
Yeah.
But what's coming across here is the stone which the builders rejected, the same
yeah.
is made the head
yeah.
of the corner.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the Jews thought that they had gathered together with Pilate and gotten rid of Jesus
yep.
by death.
Yeah.
But they have not gotten rid of Jesus.
Amen.
That's right.
And that is the burden of preaching.
Yeah.
Is that
yeah.
Jesus is seated in the heavenly place, is central in the work of salvation, and every man has to do with him.
Yes.
Every man.
Yes.
Yeah.
For the saint, though, that's a source of encouragement.
Yeah.
Because people can all day long reject Jesus and put other things as preeminent, but he is still seated on the throne.
That's right.
And for the unbeliever, this is like a wake-up call that you kiss the Son.
Amen.
That's right.
Because he has in no way been deposed.
That's right.
And it doesn't matter what the consensus says. He is on the throne.
Amen.
Yeah.
And if you do not submit to him, he is going to destroy you.
That's right.
See? And so
that, everlasting destruction.
That's a wonderful and encouraging message, brother, for all of us. Not just
yes.
not the destruction. Not that I'm... we're not rejoicing in destruction. But we are rejoicing in this. It doesn't matter how many men come against Jesus, he cannot be deposed.
That's right. Amen. Good thing. Brother Larry.
And it's not just not even started. It's not with Jesus. It's with his source. It's with the Father, which we often neglect.
God is doing this, yes.
Jesus said one place, "For I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me."
Yes.
Jesus Christ came down only by the grace and power of God Almighty. God Almighty is the one we should be praising all the time. Mm-hmm. All the praise and glory of our heart, soul, mind, and strength should be laid before God.
Yes.
For God in his magnificence, his beauty, his awesome presence came down in the form of Jesus Christ and revealed all these things to
yes.
us and did all these things for
yep.
us. So it's through God Almighty, by his grace and his mercy and his great love to us, which we thank him for.
Amen. Yeah, the Son is bringing us to the Father.
Amen.
That's what he's doing in all of this. Very good. Thank you, brethren, for your participation in our time this morning. We're going to have our recess for a few minutes and refresh ourselves in body and stretch our legs a little bit. Stand with me and we'll pray together and continue our fellowship then. Father, thank you again for your mercy and goodness. We bless you and honor you for what you've granted us to engage in the commerce of the truth, to have this truth work in us, and for it to grow larger and larger, to increase and profit us as it profits your name, your glory. We bless you in these good things. We thank you for this table that is set for us for the time of refreshment in this other manner, that we could be more rested and strengthened and able then to continue in these good things through our continuing assembly this day on the Lord's Day. We thank you for your mercy and goodness to us in all of this. We pray in Jesus, our Savior's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brethren. God's grace and peace.